That's the first time I've ever seen it.
That was awful. We'll work on it.
That's not good.
I can't get very high, so.
I thought you did great on that alto, Jennifer.
Oh, yeah, you were carrying us.
Yeah, it was pretty. It was good.
It's a beautiful song. I just not familiar enough with it to lead it. All right, glad y'all are here tonight. Rick is going to be teaching this class while we are searching for a preacher. Rick is still sick at this time, and so he should be back with us on Sunday. He's feeling much better, and his COVID wasn't too severe this time, so we're thankful for that. So tonight, I'd like to revisit with you guys. We talked back in October about Christ living in you, but we weren't able to get through the entire lesson. So there's some points that we need to talk about and some points that we need to look at that were good points. And so I felt like we needed to go back over this and make sure we hit those points as well, because it's good information for us to live by as Christians. So, can people see Jesus in you? Can they see Jesus in how you think, in how you speak, how you treat other people?
Possibly.
How you behave?
Yeah.
Okay, they can. That's true. Can people see that you spent your life trying to follow Jesus? Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, "Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8 to 10 tells us to walk as children of light. "For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness and righteousness and truth, trying to learn what is pleasing to the Lord." So if we are children of the light, then we are going to be displaying these things, these fruits of the light. You know, God said that he would know us and that we would know false teachers by their fruits. Yes. And so whatever you are producing in your life is the fruits. And so if we are trying to walk as children of light, the fruit that we're going to be involved in is goodness and righteousness and truth. And so other people should be able to see those things in us. And so that's how we can be a light to other people. All right. So, you know, we talked about before about people watching us and the things that we say and do, the way that we act, the way that we treat other people. People are watching us. And so we are constantly an example to other people, whether it's good or bad. And so as much as we may not want to be, maybe we're a shyer person and we don't really want to be in the middle of all things going on. We prefer to kind of stay in the background and not be noticed by everybody. But that's not how it works with our example. We don't have a choice. Even if we are trying to stay out of the limelight, people are still going to be watching us to see what we're doing, what we're saying, how we're acting. That's just how it is. Okay? And so what we do with our life, are we going to be a light to the world? Are we going to be darkness to the world? You know, there are people that are darkness to the world. Right? There's people that are just plain mean. Some people you might even call evil, because that's what their thoughts are centered on, is evil things and treating other people badly all the time. And we know we have the extreme circumstances where you have terrorists and you have people that are constantly trying to kill someone that they hate, right? That's the extreme version of a person that would be, you know, in darkness. And but there are people that are in darkness just because they don't know God, too. been taught God's word. Some people maybe have been taught God's word and they reject it. They don't want to know it. And if you try to teach them and try to help them, they refuse. They don't want to know. So sometimes people are in darkness because that's where they want to be. Right?
Well, nobody should want to be in the darkness.
Some people do, though.
Some people, when you approach them and you try to teach them the word of the Bible or whatever, and they push you away, what chances do you have in trying to teach them the word of the Bible if they won't listen?
You can't make somebody listen that doesn't want to.
Oh,
just can't.
I see.
You know, there's a phrase that says you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. You know, and that applies to us trying to teach other people. There's some people that don't want to know. And as badly as we want to teach them and talk to them, if they choose not to, there's not a lot you can do. Only thing you can do is continue to be the right example and live it and hope that one day they may change their minds. That's really the best thing that we can do. All right, anybody else have any comments?
You can pray for them.
Yeah, you sure can. That's very good. You can pray for them.
Like,
they will have a change of heart.
Like you said to God, I did my part and everything. I leave them in your hands. You do what should be done. And
that's
you
right.
Pray for them.
Very good. And sometimes things happen to people that make them have a change of heart.
Yes, sir.
My grandfather, he wasn't a church-going man. His wife was, my grandmother. She was very faithful, but he was not. But at one point, he had a heart attack, and it scared him pretty bad. And he went through a pretty rough time there, but he decided he better change his life because he thought he was going to die. And he was. He was close. He had open-heart surgery at that time, and that's been many years ago when open-heart surgery was a very serious procedure than it is now, but then it was even way more serious. And so he thought he was going to die. So he changed his life after that. And sometimes that happens with
yes.
people. Sometimes they will take advantage of their new opportunity, they feel like, to have a second chance at life. So that can be a good thing. All right, so if we wish to see what a Christian is, then we must investigate what the scriptures tell us. And there's many passages that describe, the Lord and what it means to walk with Christ. And if we belong to Christ, then we must separate ourselves from the world. And so that means that even though we are friends with people that are not Christians, they're not Christians, then we would say those are people that are of the world and they're not in Christ, the Christians. We have to be baptized in order to be in Christ. And so that's the people, if we say people of the world, with somebody that hasn't been baptized into Christ. And when we're around people from the world, they may have habits and be involved in activities that we can't be involved in as Christians. And so that's where we have to separate ourselves as Christians from people. If they're involved in those things, we can't just say, well, we're friends, let's go.
Yeah.
We can't do that. So we have to say, no, I can't do that as a Christian. That's not right. Paul contrasts unbelieving Gentiles with believers in Genesis and in Ephesians chapter 4. He encouraged fellow Christians to see the difference. He described the unbelievers in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17 to 19. He said, "So this I say and affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer as the Gentiles walk, in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that's in them. Because of the hardness of their hearts, they have become callous. They have given themselves over to sensuality, and and the practice of every kind of impurity and greediness. So we can see that the worldly ways of the unbelievers, Paul describes them as futile and darkened and excluded. He even goes to the point of saying they are ignorant. And so what we have to remember is whenever you're reading the word ignorant in the Bible, we're talking about people that don't know the scriptures. Okay? It's not necessary belittling that person and calling them ignorant. It's just if you don't know about brain surgery, then you are ignorant about brain surgery, right? And so not many of us have been trained in that regard, have we?
Because it's not right to call people names that you don't even know.
Right. But if you don't know the scriptures, then Paul is saying that you are ignorant of that knowledge. Not that you can't learn it and you can't gain that knowledge, but that's what he's saying here.
Ignorance, not calling somebody a name, is just another word for they don't know.
Yeah, unlearned, or they haven't been taught yet.
Uneducated.
Yeah. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 20 through 24, he said, "But you did not learn Christ in this way, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus, that in reference to your former manner of life, that you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupt in accordance with the lust of deceit, and that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self, which is in the likeness of God, and it's being created in righteousness and holiness of the truth." So when they learned about Christ, they learned about truth. They left their former lives behind, and they turned from the evil things, the lust and the deceit, and they were renewed in the spirit of their mind. Whenever they learned about God, they learned to walk like Jesus did in righteousness and holiness and in truth. And so when we belong to Christ and walk with the Lord, people ought to be able to see Jesus in our lives. And so as Christians, we should stand out among other people.
Yes.
That's why we're called to be the light of the world. People should see us as living differently, acting differently, talking differently, loving other people. Those are things that a Christian should be involved in. Mm-hmm. So if you don't mind, let's turn to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25.
God has always expected his people to be different from the world around them, whether it was the Israelites or Christians today.
Yeah, it all started with the Israelites, didn't it? He told them to be set apart, not to get involved with those that are worshiping idols, those that are committing all sorts of sins. And that's why one of the reasons that God was trying to keep them separate. So Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25 says, "Therefore, laying aside falsehood, speak truth, each one of you, with his neighbor, for we are members of one another." So it matters if the world sees us as genuine and authentic. If our actions differ from our words, then the world will see us as hypocrites. If we tell half-truths or outright lies, then the world is going to notice, and they are not going to take us seriously as a Christian. Okay? That's that we talked about last time. Would somebody like to read Ephesians 4, 26 and 27? What does that mean? Give the devil an opportunity for what?
To cause you to sin.
Yeah. To get into your life and let that sinful thoughts turn into Does the devil care about those that are in the world?
No.
He's already got the ones in the world.
They care about you.
Right.
In Christ.
Because he don't have us yet, right?
Yeah.
Satan wants as many people to go to hell with him because he knows where he's going to spend eternity.
Yes.
And so it's kind of like your friends when you're in high school and your friends are trying to get everybody to go out and drink and party and all this other. They want other people to go with them. They don't want to be the only one out there.
Yeah.
That way, if something happens or they get in trouble, everybody's going to get in trouble. It makes us feel better about the whole situation.
That's funny you mentioned that because, see, I've got this friend that lives in Austin, Texas, and I've known her for like 20 years now, and our name is Tori, and I feel like that she's gonna cross the wrong path one of these days, and I just don't know what to do to help.
Well, you know, like we were talking about before, you can make, you know, make comments and try to help her, but hopefully she'll respond whenever you do. Anger is something that Satan probably, you know, he's probably searching for us to get angry quite often because that's a good time to get us to do something sinful. When we get angry, a lot of times we say and do things that we wouldn't normally do.
Yes.
And so Satan knows that. And so he's probably sitting there going, go ahead, let it go. Go ahead. Go ahead and say that word you want to say. And so he's looking for that opportunity. Satan is. He would love to see us fall down and fall away from doing the right things. James chapter 1, verse 19 to 20 says, "This you know, my beloved brethren, but everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. For the anger of a man does not achieve the righteousness of God." So we know that God was angry, and anger in itself is not a sin, but anger can become sin if we allow it to go to that point. So we have to...
Anger becomes sin when you lose control of the emotion.
Yes, and you have to do something that is sinful. That, you know, and otherwise you might not let yourself lose control, and in that time of anger, you might let it go. Anger leads people away from God rather than fulfilling righteousness, and so we cannot get involved in that. Ephesians 4:28 says that he who steals must steal no longer, but rather he must labor, performing with his own hands what is good, so that he will have something to share with the one who has need. So God wants us to give a fair day's work for a fair day's wage. The Lord's people should be generous people who share with others what God has provided for them. And so it doesn't matter what our income is, we can still use some of that to share with other people. If you're waiting to get rich to become helpful to other people, then it's probably not going to happen. I think a lot of people think that way. Let the wealthy people do that. I need every penny I can get. But that's not what God's telling us. All right, Galatians chapter 6, verse 9.
You know, the Bible doesn't, well, at least in the New Testament anyway, the Bible doesn't put in high regard the wealthy people.
Well, you know,
I mean, there is some
the root of all evil.
Yeah, I think Nicodemus and all them were rich too. He was pretty rich, maybe it was the Joseph of Arimathea that was rich. But you know, it's being wealthy is, it's, Jesus said it's going to be hard for a rich person to enter heaven.
Yeah. It's easier for him to go through the eye of the needle.
That's it.
Than for a rich man to get into heaven.
Yeah, and then other stuff, if you give to the poor people, to all the widows stuff, everything, God see that, and God will give you abundance more.
That's right.
Because you helping
that's exactly
the
right.
people need
that's
more
how
than
it
you.
Works.
More than you.
That's how it
and
works.
Stuff. For example, if I'm rich, I got a lot of money, and I see a family in the street need food, and I know about the Bible, he said, give to the poor, and I will give you the double or triple more you have. I will give to that family money for food and stuff, for clothes, and then when time pass, I will get that money double, triple, or more money.
The way it works is,
to help the people.
You know, you don't necessarily say, I gave $5, so I'm going to get $20 next week. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no.
But if you are a giving person and you're giving out of your means that you have to other people, you will not miss that money. If you choose to say, I'm going to take this money and help here, you will not miss that money. And you'll be surprised how other blessings come your way that you didn't even realize were there. And even if they don't, none of that matters. That's not the reason for giving. The reason we are to give is because that's what we're commanded in the scriptures. That's why we are to work and provide for our families so we can have the means to help others too. That all goes hand in hand. But the only thing that matters is God sees what we do. That's all that matters. And one of the scriptures tells us, if you don't let the left hand see what the right hand is doing when you're giving. That doesn't mean literally. You don't have to put one hand behind the back when you're putting your money in the collection plate. That's not what he's saying. What he's saying is, don't brag about what you're giving or what you're doing to help other people. Because if you're doing that, God says, you've already got your reward. You're not going to get that reward from me. You've already got your reward by bragging to other people.
Yeah.
So that's not the reason to do it. We do it because it's right. God tells us.
I remember I was at Walmart one time, and I was standing there at the self-checkout, and I had this big old pocket full of change, and I was putting it all in the little machine to take it. And some guy just came up and paid for all my groceries. I don't know why. I guess maybe because I was trying to get rid of coins, I guess.
Probably
I don't know.
Thought that's all you had.
Yeah. I'm going to do that all the time now. No, but I was like, well, that was nice. But I never, I don't know.
Yeah. It's good.
I mean, I've helped people out before too, but it just feels different when it happens to you.
How many good people can be around you on this earth doing stuff like
that? Yeah, there's people, good people everywhere.
But when you look at it the other way, and that somebody just bumps into you and don't even say, excuse me, or anything, that's not the right way to be doing things like that.
That's right. But as Christians, we have to control that anger that we might feel whenever that happens and go on our way.
Because
it wouldn't be right for us to turn around and jump on that person, right? Because maybe it was a mistake when they bumped into you. Maybe they didn't mean to. Even if they did mean to do that, it's still not the right way to handle it.
Because helping people can build relationships. It's a good way to meet people,
right?
You know, to build a relationship and to, you know, make contacts and to, you know, and hopefully, you know, teach them
just
the
do
gospel
it for the right reason.
Yeah,
and the rest will work out.
Like I know
That's the right.
There's this Baptist church that every once in a while I'll go up to the laundromat and they'll pay for everybody's laundry for like, you know, however many people are there or whatever.
Yeah.
But I don't really know if they're doing it for the right reasons or not, or just to make themselves look good.
Yeah.
You know, I think they're just trying to make themselves look good because I never hear them talking to anybody about anything. Or
Galatians chapter 6, verse 9 and 10 says, "Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary." Listen to that again. Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary. What is that talking about?
That's good.
Maybe sometimes doing so much good for people can seem overwhelming, maybe.
You ever feel like you're the only one doing good?
Galatians what?
Six.
Chapter 6, verse 9 and 10.
Nice.
The point is that maybe sometimes, even in the church, we have to be careful because there's a lot of work to be done. Sometimes it seems like there's more work than we have people to do it. And so it feels overwhelming.
And my Bible says, let us not become weary and doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of belief.
Okay, so here we're being told, this is Paul talking to the Galatians. He's telling them, you've been doing good things. You guys are working hard. You're doing good things. But don't grow weary. Don't start thinking, I'm having to do all of this work and I'm not getting any help. Sometimes that's human nature for us to think like that. But what he's telling us is don't go grow weary in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary. So in other words, if we did good for 25 years, and after that 25th year, we got fed up and said, that's enough. I am so tired of working in the church and not getting any help. I'm going to stop.
Yeah.
And then they pass away the next year.
That reminds me of doing good is how we send the light into the world.
We do good in the kingdom, too.
And in the church.
That's right.
You know,
yeah.
It reminds me of that song we sing, Send the Light, and it has that lyric that says, let us not grow weary in the work of love.
Yeah.
You know,
that's why when you do good, you're not going to heaven. You got to earn.
You know, we're told that whenever we become a Christian, that gets us into Christ and into the right relationship with God. But Revelation 2:10 tells us that we have to be faithful unto death. We're faithful for 25 years, but not any longer. It's not going to be good for us on Judgment Day. God's going to know our heart. He's going to know all those reasons. But we have to be faithful to the finish line. Yes?
All the way up here, you know, up into verse 7, it's talking about, you know, being taught the word. Sometimes it
But I don't think this, in this section of scripture, of course, this can go both ways, but it says that, for let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap. And up in verse 7, it says, whatever man sows, that he'll reap. It says, for he who sows to his flesh will of his flesh reap corruption, but he who sows of the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. So I think that the what we're going to reap from doing good is the everlasting life if we don't give up. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. It's not talking always about earthly blessings, but you know, we know God's going to give that too, but the ultimate goal is the everlasting life. And that's how we build up treasures in heaven, you know.
You still have, like Jennifer's talking, a lot of times you teach for years and years and years, and you wonder, is it doing any good? Cause sometimes it seems like maybe it's not. But it is. It's doing good, and it has more of an effect than we realize. And, you know, we don't know how that's going to affect kids. There were times years ago we had a bus program here, and we were picking up kids from the projects and all over the place, and none of the parents were coming. But some of those kids turned out to be preachers, and some of those kids turned out to be, you know, strong in the church that would not have had a chance, most likely, otherwise.
It's like a school. There's a teacher. She'd be teaching almost 100 years, and she'd be teaching, and you got about 40 kids not listening, play around and stuff. She'd be teaching almost 100 years, and this one kid not play around or do nothing, I pay attention, take notes, everything. What happened? All those kids play around, do stuff, no graduate. They had to spend another year in school. And this kid listened, write notes, he graduated, went to college, have a good job. Because why? Because the teacher been teaching for 100 years and helping him out to go to college, university, get a big business. And this guy, no fool around, no nothing. And this guy come and say, teacher, thank you for all your teaching for 100 years. You teaching, your stuff, help me get education. And all this guy, fool around, play around, no listen. They still in a misery.
Yeah.
Find a job with less payment, less stuff. And it's the same stuff with a preacher. He's preaching almost 40 years and stuff. And everybody pray around. If only one family listen, that family multiply and stuff.
Well, that's what God is telling us here, you know, through Paul, is God knows our work. He knows what we're doing. He knows the effort that we're putting in, the time we're studying at home, you know. To teach a class, it's not just walk in here and teach a class and go home. There's a lot of effort that goes into it. Outside of here. And so, but God knows all those things, and God sees the effort that's been put in, and that's the reward that we'll receive is that home in heaven one day. So, but it's good to know. Good to be reminded. Don't grow weary. Let's keep working. Let's keep doing this, and we'll do the best we can with getting this church to grow. We're excited about this guy coming, Corey, on the 14th. I encourage all of you to be here. Corey Lando. He's 32 years old. He's currently a youth minister. Before that, he preached at the pulpit. And then before that, he was a missionary for the Navajo Indian Reservation. Arizona. So I imagine he has that's actually where he met his wife. She became a Christian there, and they got married. But we think he has a good experience that would help us out here. So we'll see. We're excited to hear it.
That's this coming Sunday?
No, it'll be the 14th.
Oh, the 14th.
Yeah, week after Sunday. He'll be here that week. All right, thanks for your attention, guys.